Hello everybody, in this video we are going to discuss about JAM 2018 question paper and we are going to solve all the questions step by step and we will learn all the concepts related to it. So without wasting any more time, let's start.
The first question is, which one of the following planets in the solar system is more similar in size to the Earth? So if you compare the size of different planets, then which planet has the size which is most similar to the size of the Earth, okay? And the answer to it is Venus. In this figure, you can see all the different planets in our solar system and you can compare their sizes. You can see Uranus and Neptune, they are of similar size. Jupiter and Saturn, they are quite similar type in their size. Mercury is the smallest among all of them. Then comes Mars, and after that,
we have Venus and Earth, which are quite similar in their size, okay? Next question, in which one of the following tectonic settings are the highest mountain chains and the thickest crust found? Okay, and the answer should be obvious, it should be continental collision, because when two continents collide, then none of them goes down. Okay, so when two continents collide, they break. This process may be very slow, but this process happens. Okay, and the resulting sediments pile up one above another and form fold mountains. Now, because the collision keeps on happening, so the resulting mountain also gets increased in its size. That's the reason why we say that the height of Himalaya is still rising nowadays. You can see here we have some examples of Mid-Atlantic Ridge, which is a Mid-Oceanic Ridge, and the highest peak of Mid-Atlantic Ridge has a height of 2351 meters. Whereas when two continents collide, we get an example there in case of Himalayan mountain, and the highest peak it has, which is Mount Everest, whose height is 8848 meters and it's still rising. Okay. Now, if we talk about island arc, then Aleutian Alaska arc is an example of an island arc whose highest peak is 3108 meters. And if you consider continental arc, then Cascade Volcanic arc is an example of it and whose highest mountain range is 4392 meters. So here you can clearly see that the peak that is formed by continental collision, that is Himalaya, clearly wins the race here in case of height. Okay. Next question. The second most abundant oxide in the earth crust is? And the answer should be L2O3. Here you can see a list of oxides and their abundance in the earth crust. First we have silicon oxide, that is SiO2. Then we have MgO and FeO, which are not in the options. So next comes L2O3. So our answer will be L2O3. Okay. Next question, the type of dentition found in Trigonia is? And the answer should be Cyzodont. Okay. Next question, which one of the following minerals has isolated SiO4 tetrahedra linked by divalent cations in octahedral coordination? And you also know that nesosilicate is also called the island silicate because it has isolated SiO4 tetrahedra. And the answer here is olivine, which is a nesosilicate. You can see beryl is a cyclosilicate, quartz is a tectosilicate, and muscovite is a phyllosilicate. Okay, next question. Which one of the following is not found in an extensional setting? And the answer should be thrust fault. In this figure, you can see there is rift valley formation, there is horst and graben structure, and there is normal fault in case of divergent boundary. But thrust fault occurs if there is some kind of collision or some kind of convergent boundary present. Okay. The next question, the texture characterized by exsolved lamellae of albite in Cape Feldspar is known as? And the answer is perthite. In perthitic texture, the orthoclase is to albite ratio is 42:58. Similarly, in case of graphic texture, there is orthoclase and quartz where the ratio is 72.5:27.5. Okay, so the graphic texture is between orthoclase and quartz, perthitic texture is between albite and orthoclase, marmakitic texture is between quartz and feldspar. Okay, next question, fissility is best shown by? And the answer should be cell. Now, what is fissility? Fissility is the tendency of a rock to split along the flat planes of weakness. Okay, there are some plane of weakness, there are some plane along which the rock has a tendency to split apart. This is called fissility, and cell is the best example showing fissility. Okay. Next question, petroleum is not commercially produced from? And the answer should be Bindhyan Basin, because except Bindhyan Basin, all the basins that are in option has produced petroleum commercially. ओके नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन अमंग द फॉलोइंग मिनरल व्हिच मिनरल शोज एसिकुलर हैबिट एंड द आंसर शुड बी सिलिमानाइट इट शोज एसिकुलर हैबिट ओके नाउ दिस क्वेश्चन इज आस्क्ड इन वेरियस एग्जामिनेशंस इन द पास्ट सो प्लीज ट्राई टू रिमेंबर द हैबिट ऑफ मिनरल्स एज वेल ओके इट्स एन इंपॉर्टेंट फिजिकल प्रॉपर्टी ऑफ मिनरल्स सो नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन आइसोस्टासी इन्वॉल्व्स डैश कॉन्टिनेंटल माउंटेन बेल्ट्स एंड द आंसर शुड बी कॉम्पेंसेशन इन कॉन्टिनेंटल माउंटेन बेल्ट्स एंड यू कैन सी हियर बिकॉज देर इज एन अपलिफ्टमेंट अबव द ग्राउंड सर्फेस सो इन ऑर्डर टू कॉम्पेंसेट दैट हाइट सम पार्ट ऑफ इट इज ऑल्सो प्रेजेंट बीनीथ द ग्राउंड ओके दिस इज कॉल्ड द कॉम्पेंसेशन ऑफ कॉन्टिनेंटल माउंटेन बेल्ट्स एंड द कॉन्सेप्ट इज कॉल्ड आइसोस्टासी नाउ देर इज थ्री थियोरीज यू नो दैट वन इज Eris hypothesis, second one is Pratt's hypothesis, and the third one is Heskanen's hypothesis. Okay, we will deal with this in detail when we discuss isostasy as a separate topic. Okay, next question: identify the pair from the following list that is not correctly matched, and the answer should be pillow basalt, which is here written it is of subaerial eruption, but it is not the answer because pillow basalt is formed when the magma while erupting it comes in contact with water and that's why the structure that is formed is called pillow structure next question wilson's orogenic cycle in continents is initiated by and the answer is it is initiated by rifting in this figure you can see different stages of wilson cycle and the first step in the right hand side you can see it is formation of rift basin so the first step in wilson cycle is rifting okay next question Next we have a match the column question and the answer should be in dissolution we find sinkholes for abrasion we get mushroom rocks for deposition we get moraines and for onion skin weathering we get exfoliation domes you can see the figures here and you can clearly relate the structures with their process of formation okay you see due to deposition the moraines are formed due to abrasion mushroom rocks are formed and sinkholes are formed due to dissolution and finally exfoliation forms due to onion skin weathering okay next question the orientation of the fold axis and the axial plane in the given figure indicate and the answer should be it is a reclined fold because in this figure you can see axial plane has some dip and the fold axis has some plunge as well so the answer should be reclined fold in the next question we have to identify the parts of an ichnoid so the part indicated as one is periproct and the part indicated in second is ambulacra and the third is interambulacra and the fourth should be peristome okay next question the correct order of marine benthic habitats with increasing water depth is and you can see in this figure they are in the order of neritic bathyal and abyssal next which one of the following invertebrates has the most primitive visual system and the answer is trilobites next the correct chronological sequence of the precambrian stratigraphic units listed below is here the oldest among all of these is sargur group which is of dharwar age next chitradurga group which is also of dharwar craton next we have alwar group which is a part of delhi super group and at last we have kaimur group next we have a match the column option in which we have to match the groups along with their characteristics fossils so in barakar formation we get glossopteris in dogpatan formation we get belemnites in uttatur formation we get belemnites in dogpatan formation we get stegodon and in lamata formation we get storopoda okay next which one of the following sedimentary structure is not used for the determination of top and bottom beds and the answer here should be plain lamination because see mud cracks are formed when the sediments dies and contracts and it occurs in clay soils as a result of reduction in water content here the top layer tries to sink while the materials below stays the same size okay that's why there is the formation of cracks on it so when the mud cracks preserved on the top of a bed the cracks look as if they were at the time of formation you can see in this figure the first one is a recent mud crack and the second one is a mud crack which is preserved in the base so you can clearly differentiate which one is younger and which one is older by saying at the mud cracks next we have load and frame structure and here also we can say that which bed is top and which bed is at the bottom okay next see this is the sharp crested ripple on the top and the bottom figure we have the movement of the water current is both ways so we get a symmetrical ripple there but in second case we have a current direction from a particular direction and that's why asymmetrical crested ripples are formed So, from mud cracks, load and frame structure, and from sharp crested ripples, we can determine the top and bottom of a bed. But for a plain lamination, we cannot say which part is top and which part of is bottom. Next question, identify the rock P and Q in the diagram as per the IUGS classification. Now see, in this figure we have olefin, orthopyroxene and clinopyroxene as the three end members. So the rock at P should be hasbergite, Q we should get ferrite. Here in this diagram we can see, for the first diagram we have olefin, orthopyroxene and clinopyroxene as three end members. So if a rock contains olefin and orthopyroxene and very little amount of clinopyroxene, then it should be hasbergite. And if a rock contains olefin and clinopyroxene but a very little amount of orthopyroxene, then it is called ferrite. And if a rock contains orthopyroxene and clinopyroxene and a very little amount of olefin, then it should be websterite. Okay. And if the rock contains olefin, orthopyroxene and clinopyroxene in nearly equal amount, then the answer should be either laterzolite or olefin websterite. Okay. Next, which one of the following is produced by a closed system metamorphic reaction between muscovite and quartz? So in a closed system reaction, there is no net gain or loss of element. That is, you can say the total mass of the system remains constant. And here, if we allow muscovite and quartz to react, then we will get orthoclase and sillimanite in a closed system. Next, the assemblage staurolite plus garnet plus biotite, muscovite plus quartz in a pellitic is stable in here. The assemblage given here should be of amphibolite phases. But if you increase the temperature and pressure condition a little bit, then the amphibolite phases changes to granulite phases where there is no hydrous mineral present. Like biotite, muscovite, nothing is present there. Next question, conglomerates are commonly deposited in, and the answer should be they are deposited in alluvial fans. Next we have a master column question where we have to arrange the mineral deposits with their corresponding Indian occurrence. So for iron we have phosphate in Karnataka, for uranium we have Narwa Pahar in Jharkhand, for manganese deposit we have Balghat in Madhya Pradesh, and for barite we get it in Mangampet, which is in Andhra Pradesh. Okay. Next question, which one of the following process is responsible for the formation of syngenetic nickel copper ore in gabbronoritic rocks? Now see, generally you get sulfide ores in two cases, in oxidation supergene enrichment and in magmatic processes. Now see, sulfides are immiscible in the magma, and as a result, after a very small decrease in the temperature, the sulfide part gets separated. And that's why we get nickel copper sulfides in gabbro and noritic rocks by the process of liquid immiscibility. Okay. Next, the dashed line in the figure below represent joints. Considering only the orientation of the joint and the slope face, which one of the following represents the most stable slope? Now see, when the slope and the joint part they have opposite in the dip, then we will get the most stable part. And here in all the cases we get the slope and the joint, the dip at a particular direction. But only in option B we get that the slope and the dip of the joint, they are in opposite direction. So our answer will be option B. Next we have the morphological features in group 1, and in group 2 we have their corresponding organisms. So we get water vascular system in echinoderms, we get molting in trilobites, for jet propulsion locomotion we get it in cephalopoda, and simple for lophopore we found it in brachiopoda. Okay. Next question, match the plutonic rocks in group 1 with the corresponding volcanic equivalent in group 2. So we have to match the plutonic and the volcanic equivalent of the rocks. Now for granite we have rhyolite, for sienite we have trachyte, for diorite we have andesite, and for gabbro we have basalt. Okay. Next question, which one of the following changes when a dipping bed with a plunging lineation is rotated about its vertical axis? So when a structure is rotated about the vertical axis, so there is no change in the dip or the plunge amount, but there is the change in the dip and the plunge direction of the structure. Okay. That is, there is no change in the amount of the plunge or dip, but there is change in only the direction of it. Our answer is plunge direction of the lineation and the strike of the bed would change. Okay. Next question, which of the following indicates the presence of directed stress in a rock? And we get it in sistrosity, nisosity, and in myelinite structure. Because in all of these, we get it in metamorphism, where we get a directed stress. But in porphyritic texture, there is no such directed stress concept. Next question. The correct combination of ranks and the corresponding categories of stratigraphic units are. Now here, the formation is a lithostratigraphic unit and the system is a chronostratigraphic unit. That is the correct answers. Okay. Next question. The correct order of stability of silica polymorphs with increasing pressure is. And if you look at the stability diagram of quartz polymorphs, then you will find that the first option is correct, that is quartz, after that quartzite and then strisovite. And also the third option is also correct, that is first tridymite, then after it is quartzite and after it is strisovite. Okay. Next question. Which one of the following statement is correct for the upper hemisphere stratigraphic projection of a crystal given below? Now see, whenever we project a crystal, we project it in the upper hemisphere. And whenever we project any structural data like a dip or a strike, a plunge, a pitch or a lineation, etc., then we project it in the lower hemisphere. Okay, remember it. Now here, the angle between alpha, beta and gamma is 90 degrees. It is correct. The crystal contains only one tetrad, that is at the central along the c-axis. So this is also correct. The crystal contains four diodes. You can see. You can see there is a structure for diode that is also marked in the question. And on the periphery of the circle, if you count, then you will get total 8 number of diode structures that represents the diodes. Okay. And for a particular diode, we use 2 of those structures to show only one diode. So there are 8 of them here. So we will get 4 diodes for them. Now because all the lines are solid here, so we will get 5 mirror planes. One mirror plane perpendicular to the fourfold axis, that is one tetrad, and other 4 mirror planes are perpendicular to the diodes, that is twofold axis. Okay. Now because we have 4 twofold axis and 1 fourfold axis here, so the total number of mirror planes we get will be 5. So all the options that are given in the answer is correct. Okay. Next question. Which one of the following statement is correct? And see, an isotropic mineral remains dark through 360 degree rotation of the stage under cross Nichols. This is correct. Okay. Next, pleochroism is the change of color of a mineral during rotation under crossed polars. This crossed polars part is wrong, because this is the change of color of minerals during the rotation under plane polarized light. Okay, PPL condition. Next, the minerals of triclinic systems are optically uniaxial. This is wrong, because the minerals of triclinic system are optically biaxial. Last option, the melatope is an interference figure, marks the emergence of an optic axis. This is the correct answer. So our answer will be option A and option D. Okay. Next, hermatypic corals are typically found in, and they are found in photic zone, they are found in warm and clear water, and they are also found in reefs. But remember, they are not found in cold and deep water. Okay. They are found in photic zone, that is upper part, and in the warm and clear water. Okay. Next, choose the characteristics mineral formed in the supergene enrichment zone of a sulfide deposit. Now in the supergene enriched zone, we will get covellite and chalcocite among these. Next, which one of the following is true for the crystallization of plagioclase phenocryst from a basic magma forming a layered intrusion? Okay. And the answer is all the three, that is cumulus structure is formed at the base, and the andotite tree's early plagioclase is also at the base, and the albite tree's late plagioclase is at the top. Okay. Next, the major mass extinction event occurred in, and the answer here should be end of Permian, that is at the PT boundary, that is Permian Triassic boundary. Okay. Now mark here, it is mentioned major mass extinction. That's why the answer is only one, that is Permian. Okay. Next, we have the numerical type questions. The first question is, when plotted on a map of 1:50,000 scale, a 2 km long dike exposed on the horizontal surface has a length of -cm. And you have to mark the sentence here. The answer is in one decimal place. So whenever you write the answer, write it in one decimal form. So let's see. Here 50,000 cm means 0.5 km. Okay. So 1 cm in the map equal to 0.5 km on the ground, because that is the scale given in the question. Okay. So if a dike is 2 km long on the ground, then in the map it should be 1/0.5×2, that is 4 cm. So you have to write the answer like 4.0, because it is written to write the answer in one decimal place. Okay. So if you write only 4, then there are chances that you might end up losing the mark. Okay, so please make sure that you answer the question and the way that is asked in the question. Okay, next question, valency of iron in hematite is? This question is a pretty simple question. See, in hematite we have the formula Fe2O3. So in anion we have 3 oxygens here, okay, and each oxygen has -2 charges in it. So the total number of negative charges we will get here is -6. Okay, now because it is a electrically neutral compound, so there must be same number of charges in the cation side as well in a positive manner, right? So we will have +6 as a cation, and there is 2 iron atoms, so the charge on each iron should be +3. Okay, next question, a crustal rock is at a lithospheric pressure of 3 kilobar and a temperature of 275 degrees Celsius. If the lithospheric pressure increases at a uniform rate of 0.3 kilobar per kilometer and the surface temperature is 25 degrees Celsius, then the geothermal gradient in degrees Celsius per kilometer is, and the answer in one decimal place. So now the situation is that the rock is present at a particular depth, okay, and the temperature and the pressure condition of that particular plate is given below. Now here, as it is written that the lithospheric pressure increases at a uniform rate of 0.3 kilobar per km, here it is written that if you move from the surface into the earth, then the pressure increases, okay. Some people gets confused there, so mind it is written from the surface into the earth. The pressure at depth is 3 kilobar and the change in pressure, that is the pressure gradient, is 0.3 kilobar per kilometer. So the total depth of the rock should be 3 divided by 0.3, that is 10 kilometers. Now the temperature at that particular depth, that is at 10 kilometer, is 275 degrees Celsius, and it is given in the question, okay. And the surface temperature given is 25 degree. So the total change in temperature as you move from surface to underground is 275 minus 25, that is 250 degrees Celsius, and we have calculated the total depth as 10 kilometers. So the geothermal gradient is 250 divided by 10, that is 25 degrees Celsius per kilometer. Okay, next question, the absolute difference in moles in Mohr's hardness values of two silicates among the minerals listed below is. Now see, here we have the total Mohr's hardness scale, and among the minerals listed we have only talc and topaz as the silicate minerals. Now see, it is written the absolute difference, it is not the absolute hardness difference, okay. It is the relative hardness difference, but the exact difference, that is the absolute difference, okay. Some people make mistakes here, they think that it is of absolute hardness difference, but it is the relative hardness difference, okay. And for talc we have a hardness of 1, and for topaz we have a hardness of 8. So if you subtract it, then you will get the answer as 7, okay. Next, the attitude of beds in sequence A and B separated by an unconformity UU are given in the following sectional view. If UU has a horizontal when a sequence A was deposited, the deep amount of the beds in sequence B at the time was, and the answer should be in one decimal place. Now see, the bed B is dipping in northwest direction and the unconformity dipping in southeast direction, which is opposite to it, okay. So in these cases, if we are asked if UU was horizontal, then find the deep amount at sequence B, then in this case you have to add up all these things, that is you have to add up the deep amount of the bed and the unconformity, okay. So here the answer will be 50 degree. But suppose we encounter a case where bed and the unconformity dip in the same direction. So if you are given the same question in that condition, then you will answer as the difference of their dips should be the answer, okay. Here we have added up the dips, but their dips are in the same direction, then you have to subtract the bigger one, you have to subtract the smaller one from the bigger one, okay. The next question, the number of alpha particles emitted to produce a daughter isotope of 206 lead from a parent isotope of 238 uranium by radioactive decay is. Now let's understand what is alpha particle. Alpha particle is helium 4-2, okay, which has a mass number of 4 and atomic number of 2, right? And in radioactive decay, we follow the law of conservation of mass. That is, for 238 uranium, if it is get converted, so in the product side, we must get 238, okay? And the 238 uranium produced 206 plumbum and alpha particle, okay?
So in order to get the number of alpha particle, we just subtract 238 from 206 and divide the total number by 4. And we get the answer as 8. So there are total 8 number of alpha particles formed for one molecule of 238 uranium. Okay. Next question. The deep sleep of fault 000 degree and 30 degree east is 10 meter. Assuming sleep equals separation here, the throw on the fault is dash meters. Answer in one decimal place. Okay. Now look at the triangle here. We have given the deep sleep as 10 meter. So the hypotenuse here should be the deep sleep, that is 10 meters. Okay. And the 30 degree east is the deep angle. And we are asked about the throw of the fault. So sin theta equal to throw divided by hypotenuse, that is P divided by H. So here we have throw divided by 10. So now if you calculate the throw, then we will get the throw value as 5 meters. Okay. Next question. A continuous 10 meter thick sequence of cell was deposited in 10,000 years at a uniform rate of sedimentation. The number of samples that must be collected at equal stratigraphic intervals to sample the succession every 500 years each. So here we collect one sample every 500 years and we have total 10,000 years. So the number of sample calculated should be. The answer should be very simple. 10,000 divided by 500. So the answer should be 20. Okay. Next question. The attitude of two limbs of a non-plunging king fault shown below are 45 degree and 20 degree southeast and 45 degree 40 degree northwest. The deep amount of the axial plane of the king fault is, and the answer should be in one decimal place. Now look at the figure here. Now 40 degree plus 2x, that is the x and x from left and right side, and 20 degree at the right side, all sum up to form 180 degree. Okay. So if you calculate the value of x, it comes out to be 60 degree. So now you have to calculate the true deep value. So now if you add 60 degree to the 40 degree part, then we will get 100 degree. But the true deep cannot exceed 90 degree. So the true deep must be 20 degree plus 60 degree, that is 80 degree. Next question. In the Garnet formula, Fe2.5, Mg0.3 and calcium X, Al2Si3O12, X represents the number of atoms of calcium. The mole percentage of grossular in garnet is dash. And the answer is in one decimal place. Okay. So the general formula of garnet is A3B2Si3O12. Now for A, we have Fe, Mg and Ca here. And for B, we have aluminium. Now see. Fe, Mg and calcium, all of them must add up to form 3. But Fe plus Mg already forms 2.8. So X would be 0.2. Okay. Now the mole percentage of Grossler is 0.2 divided by the total number of atoms, that is 0.2 by 3 into 100. And the answer should be 6.7%. Okay. Next question. Assuming the Earth to be an ideal sphere, the volume percentage of the core relative to the total volume of the Earth is dash. And the answer is in one decimal place. Now see, the radius of the core is 6371 kilometers minus 2900 kilometers. Because up to 2900 kilometers we have mantle. Okay. So if you subtract the value of mantle from the total radius of the Earth, then we will get the radius of the core. Okay. Now for the radius of the Earth, 6371 kilometers. So the volume percentage is 3471 cube divided by 6371 cube whole into 100. And if you calculate, then you will get the answer as 16.11%. Okay. Next, based on 8 oxygen atom, the number of silicon atoms in plagioclase of composition Al2O20 and Al2O30 is, and the answer is in one decimal place. Now see, in albite we have NaAlSi3O8, there are 3 moles of silicon, and for anorthite we have CaAl2Si2O8, so there is 2 moles of silicon there. Okay. Now for Al2O20 and Al2O30, we will have silica equal to 80 divided by 100 into 2 plus 20 divided by 100 into 3, because anorthite is 80% and albite is 20%. In albite we have 3 moles of silicon and in anorthite we have 3 moles of silicon. Okay. Now if you calculate, then we will get that the number of silicon atoms we will get here is 2.2. Okay. Next question. 600 tons of low grade iron ore are blended with 400 tons of high grade iron ore, that is 65% iron. The grade of the blended ore is dash percentage iron. So here you have to multiply the total amount of ore along with their grade value and divide the total number by 100. So 600 into 40% plus 400 into 65% divided by 100. Okay, and if you calculate, then you will get it as 500. Now the grade of the blended iron that is formed is 500 divided by 1000, because now the total amount of ore we get is 600 plus 400, that is 1000. Okay, so the grade of blended iron here is 500 divided by 1000 into 100, okay, which is 50%, right? Question: the mass of a fully dried rock sample of volume 100 cm3 is 300 gram, and the mass of sample when fully saturated with water of density 1 gram per cc is 325 gram. Assuming no volume change, the computed porosity of the rock is dash percentage. Okay. Answer in one decimal place. Now see, after it is fully saturated with water, we have the mass as 325 gram, and before it, we have the mass as 300 grams. So the volume of the void here is 325 minus 300, that is 25 cc. Okay. And the porosity formula is volume of voids divided by total volume of rock into 100, that is 25 divided by 100 into 100, and the result comes out to be 25%. Okay, now see, here we directly convert this much amount of water equal to this much gram. That's because the density of water is 1 gram per cc. But in case we are given any hypothetical liquid whose density is not 1 gram per cc, then we have to convert the mass into volume by the formula mass by volume equal to density. Okay. Next question: when a dunite comprising pure crustite undergoes melting, the wet percentage of MgO in the melt is dash. And the answer in one decimal place. Given the molecular weight of SiO2 is 60.08 and that of MgO is 40.30. Now see, the formula of crustite is Mg2SiO4. We will have, for 1 mole of crustite, we have 2 mole of MgO and 1 mole of SiO2. So the weight percentage of MgO equal to 2 into the molecular mass of MgO divided by 2 into molecular mass of MgO plus molecular mass of SiO2, that is the total molecular mass, whole multiplied by 100. And if you plot the values in the particular equation, then you will get the answer as 57.3, right? Next question: a block of rock with a mass of 72 kg slides on a surface inclined at an angle of 30 degree as shown in the figure. Assuming no cohesion and friction, the force F is Newton. Now see, answer in one decimal place, and the acceleration due to gravity is 9.8 meter per second square. Okay. Now see, when the block moves downward, then the gravitational force acting on it is Mg, which is downward. And if you want to find the component of Mg along the direction in which the block is sliding, then it must be Mg sin theta. So here we have, here mass of the substance is given, the value of acceleration due to gravity is given, and if you put all these in the equation, then you will get the answer as 352.8 Newton. Okay. Next question: the true thickness of bed A in the map below is dash meters. Answer in one decimal place. Now see, this is also a thickness of bed problem, but it is represented in a different way. So if you closely look at the map, so the situation represented in the map can be reconstructed as something like this, where the vertical distance is 100 and the horizontal distance is 200. Now for the depth of the bed, we will have tan theta equal to vertical distance by horizontal distance, and if you calculate the value of theta, then it comes out to be 26.56 degree. So now if you want to calculate the true thickness of the bed, then you have to put sin theta in the smaller triangle, sin theta equal to p by h. So p equals to 200 into sin of 26.56 degree, which is equals to 0.447. And if you will multiply, you will get the answer as 89.92. Next, a melt containing 900 moles of anorthite and 100 moles of diopside undergoes crystallization. The number of moles of anorthite that crystallizes as the melt composition moves from P to Q is, now see, at P we have 900 moles of anorthite and 100 moles of diopside. Okay. But look at the point Q, where the point Q is situated. At that point, the composition is 50-50. So that means
By the time the reaction has proceeded to that point, at there, the composition of anorthite and diopside must be 50-50. But as you know, before the eutectic point, no diopside will crystallize. So the total amount of diopside present in the melt from P to Q must be 100 only, right? So along P to Q, we will get only anorthite. Now at Q, we have 100 moles of diopside, that is clear. And also at Q, we will have 50-50 concentration of both diopside and anorthite. That means at Q, we will have only 100 moles of anorthite. Now this is only the key point in this question. So now that we have known that only 100 moles of anorthite is left, and at first 900 moles of anorthite, so the number of moles of anorthite that crystallize till the melt reach the composition of Q is 900 minus 100, that is 800 moles. Okay. Next, a confined sandstone aquifer with a uniform cross-sectional area of 7 meter cube and a hydraulic conductivity of 2 meter per second transmits water across a hydraulic gradient of 3.2. Assuming steady state Darcy flow, the volumetric flow rate to the aquifer is dash meter cube per second. The answer in one decimal place. So see, Q equal to Ka dS by dL, where K is the hydraulic conductivity, A is the total cross-sectional area, and dS by dL is the hydraulic gradient. So now if you put these values, you will get the answer as 44.8 meter cube per second. Okay. The last question. A diamondiferous lamprophyte is ultra potassic and has a molar K2O by Na2O ratio of 11. If the Na2O content of the rock is 0.628%, then the K2O content is dash weight percentage. Answer in one decimal place. The molecular weight of Na2O is 61.98 and that of K2O is 94.20. Now see, let the number of moles of Na2O is X. So the number of moles of K2O will be 11X. Now the total mass of Na2O is X into 61.98 and that of the total mass of K2O is 11X into 94.2. Okay. So 61.98X is 0.62%. And we have to calculate what is the weight percentage of K2O. So 11X into 94.20% will be 62 divided by 100 whole into 94.2 divided by 61.98. If you will calculate, you will get the answer as 10.4. Okay.